Urging, and I'm happy to announce our today's speaker, Vadim Schechtman from Paul-Sabatier University, Toulouse. He will speak about, well, I could say relativity and reciprocity. Formal title will appear soon. Please, Vadim, go ahead.
Okay, let me first okay, do you see my screen?
Yes, I do.
Let me see. Okay, let's try this version. If it will not be good, I will try another version of. So, yes. Sorry. Let me try another version. I will see. So you see this, you see the screen, right? Okay, so I will speak a little bit about the following two subjects. So Lorentz group of cyclotomic extensions. So I will discuss some relationships between two seemingly separated topics. One of them is special relativity, some basics of special relativity and Lorentz group. And another one is some construction which appeared in Japanese works, which relates so-called Kummer and Artin-Schreier extensions from which are basic number theory. So let me. So it will be some history. So at the beginning of 20th century, it was some coincidence. There appeared two articles. One of them has been published in Annalen der Physik, and the other one has appeared in Mathematischen Annalen. Okay. So the second one was written by a mathematician, Philipp Friedrich Furtwängler, and it dealt with reciprocity with the generalization of a reciprocity law, of a quadratic reciprocity law. Of course, the people looked for such generalizations from the very beginning, and everyone, all number theory classics proposed their own proofs of quadratic reciprocity, and then proposed other reciprocity laws. At the moment, at the beginning of 20th century, Hilbert Zahlung-Bericht has already appeared. So he proposed what was called power reciprocity law related to roots of unity. And Furtwängler had some remarkable progress in this direction. And he wrote two articles, which are in the references. Okay, so here, this Philipp Friedrich Furtwängler. So it was a remarkable German mathematician. His advisor was Felix Klein, and among his students has been, for example, Wolfgang Gröbner and Otto Schreier, the same Otto Schreier, which is Artin Schreier. So number theorist. Okay. And actually, Furtwängler paper was recalled, was remembered maybe 80 years later in the work of two Japanese mathematicians, Sekiguchi and Suwa. Remarked that this paper is closely connected with their studies of, so to say, approximation from Kummer to Artin Schreier. I will talk about this later. The first mentioned paper is the paper of Albert Einstein. Let me show it to you. So Elektrodynamik bewegter Körper. This is a paper where he formulated the the special relativity theory. Of course, 1905 was a remarkable year. In this year, Einstein published 5 papers, which and all 5 became classics. I mean, he worked in Swiss in the patent bureau, and published in 1 year 5 papers. Yes. So this paper is the special relativity paper. The main hero in this paper was actually found earlier. This was a formula for addition of velocity, relativistic addition formula. It was found probably by Lorentz. So here it's, you will see. Here is Lorentz. He was apparently, this is a Dutch physicist. And you see a gentle person, and he got Nobel Prize for theoretical explanation of Zeeman effect, so-called, in 1904. what did Einstein, this is, which is remarkable, I should say, that he deduced the Lorentz formula, from postulate of constants of light velocity. And this deduction is remarkable, if you wish, and very well very well described in some sources. So for me, it was useful to to listen to the lecture of my colleague, a physicist. I didn't know this deduction. It's a remarkable thing. And this was one source of this little note. And the other source was a note of my colleague, a mathematician, Toyn, who with co-authors in completely different domain, who used the Sekiguchi Suwa construction in generalization of so-called HKRR theorem, Hochschild constant Rosenberg theorem, to characteristic P. And there he used this deformation story. You will see some details below. Okay. So let's start from relativistic addition law. So we'll work in algebraic setting. So let's introduce addition by the following formula 1 1 1. Okay. So you see H is some parameter. So you see that if H is equal to zero, it is a usual addition of numbers. When H is not equal to zero, it is some deformed addition. So physically H is one over speed of light. Here I denoted H as Planck constant, but it's not Planck constant, like deformation parameter. Okay, so note that you can write this as follows. In the numerator, you have the first elementary symmetric function, and in the denominator, you have one, which can be considered as zeros, elementary symmetric function, plus h squared times sigma two, right? So then note if you iterate this addition, then this addition law is associative, commutativity is trivial, but it is associative. And then you find some formula, the following formula, sigma one plus h squared sigma two, whereas at the denominator we have one plus h four, sorry, in the numerator, sigma one plus h two sigma three, whereas in numerator we have one plus h four sigma two, and so on. So three numbers, then you have sigma one h squared sigma three, in the denominator one plus h squared sigma two plus h four sigma four, and so on. So you see the rule. This is an interesting a priori non-trivial conclusion. So any comments are welcome. I think it's an interesting formula. So in the numerator you have odd elementary symmetric functions, whereas in the denominator you have even elementary symmetric functions. They appear directly from Lorentz Einstein formula. Okay. So I should say, just as a side remark, I should say that a similar formula appear as addition of solitons in two-dimensional tone field theory. Okay, I'll tell something about it later. Okay, so let's move along. So how can we consider this algebra? So let's consider actually the topic of all this talk will be some manipulations inside SL2. So let's start with that. So let's consider the matrices AH, which are written here. So you see, when H is equal to zero, it will be just lower triangular matrices. Whereas H is not zero, then there are some matrices, okay? So let's introduce on K square a scalar product of Lorentz and type. Then the matrix is orthogonal with respect to this scalar A of U is orthogonal, okay? Also, if we multiply these two matrices, then we get the following. AU AV is 1 plus H square AU plus V. What is 1 plus H square? This is nothing else but the determinant of our matrix, right? Okay, so we can pass to determinant. and see this property. So we can make this extra factor disappear just by dividing by the square root of this expression, right? So if we consider, so if we consider the matrices B, which is A divided by square root of this determinant, they will satisfy the rule 1, 2, 4. Just product of these matrices are corresponding to U and V is this matrix B corresponding to U plus with this deformant plus. Okay. Otherwise, we can say that this determinant is like a co-boundary, becomes co-boundary in the SL2. Okay. So this matrix is B, this is what appears in the physical interpretation, actually. So the physical interpretation is that when we have some observer which is living on the line, which is moving with the velocity u. By the way, do you see me, or you see only the text?
It's just.
But
I see you and I see the text.
Okay, good. Just a formal question. So you have an observer which lives on a straight line, so, and moves with the velocity u, and he also can measure the time. And then we want to compare its time and coordinates when they are moving, and it turns out that they are related by this matrix, by BH. This is Lorentz formula. Okay. This is a special relativity formula in a 1 plus 1 dimensional situation, not 3 plus 1 as in our space, but 1 plus 1. In 3 plus 1, there would be SO3, and here it's SO11. Okay, another remark is that interesting case is that everything is real. So using these matrices, we can define actually this deformed addition law on the interval from minus C to C. When C, so C is H inversed, this is, so to say, light velocity. and we can see that we'll see below that actually this deformed law actually is isomorphic to the usual multiplicative law. Okay. So this means that our formulas, our matrices, give us a family of tori, if you wish, of multiplicative groups inside SL2R, which at the when C tends to infinity, which means H is zero, becomes orispheric group, nilpotent, unipotent. And this is very, a remarkable thing and very important thing. Okay, so we can also replace in this situation Lorentzian scalar product by the usual scalar product, and then instead of R star, we'll get compact tori. So we get a family of what is compact torus? It is a circle. So we get a family of tori in SL2R, which are for almost all values of a parameter are just compact circles. At infinity, it gets orispheric group. This is important phenomenon, actually, important in number theory. And this is this is close to the following. So this is in the theory of functions. This is related to a deformation of usual Gauss hypergeometric functions to confluent hypergeometric functions, which are very nice description in the Whittaker Watson textbook. Actually, I should say that probably the best in my modest opinion, it's the best book on analysis written in the history of mathematics, second tome. Okay, so from Gauss to Whittaker. So they could be considered either as Whittaker functions could be considered either as deformations of Gauss functions or as a sort of Fourier transform. This is another story. And in physical language, this corresponds what is called from Calogero-Moser integrable systems to Toda integrable system. On philosophical level, I should say that by some reason, Whittaker functions in number theory are more important. It's not completely clear to me, at least, why, but this is c'est la vie. So this would, yes, it's what happens. Of course, these orispheric subgroups are at the base of the story. Okay, so let's return to our formal situation. So we claim that when H is not equal to zero, our group law is more or less isomorphic to multiplicative law. So let's, I want to consider this formula. And then it follows the following formula, okay? Which is 2-1-1, which means actually that we have a map, I denoted it BH, from our group law LH to GM, given by this formula, and it will be a morphism of group laws. So I must say that here, when I see group law, I'm a little bit not precise. You see here square roots, actually. So you should pass to either to formal groups when it is possible to extract these square roots, or to some coverings. So I will, let me skip this, although it might be important. So if we, from the formula from beta, we easily derive the formula for the inverse map, which altogether, this means that these two group laws are at least birationally, they are isomorphic. And okay, so for each, so the conclusion that for each different from zero, it's if k is a field, our group law is multiplicative law. Whereas for, as I mentioned, as it is clear from the very beginning, for h equal to zero, it is additive law. So this is a deformation from additive, from multiplicative law to additive law. This is the meaning of Lorentz law. But here it appears already inside SL2. This is a sort of new point, which it's not, yes. Okay, so another way of looking at the same group is the following. We could look at the eigenvalues of our matrices A, which will be different from when H is different from zero. And we can diagonalize our matrix, which means actually, which would mean that this subgroup LH, which we have constructed in SL2, is actually by means of this matrix CH is conjugated to the standard maximal torus. Of course, when H is equal to zero, then this matrix is degenerate. So, but when H is different from zero, our matrix is conjugated to standard torus. So we get a family of tori conjugated, which degenerate to unipotent subgroup. Okay, to orispheric. This is Gelfand terminology, which comes from Poincaré. Classical terminology, which liked Israel Moiseevich liked. Okay. Now I will come to the group, to the other part of my story. This is the group which was considered by Japanese mathematicians, Sekiguchi and Suwa. And they wrote an article, they wrote many articles together. And one of them was written in co-authorship with Ort, Franz Ort. I don't know his nationality, but he wrote it in French. He wrote in France, probably. Okay, so I will, so here you see the name of Sekiguchi, the it is, so Sekiguchi Tsutomu. Tsutomu is a first name. So Seki means barrier, and Guchi, you see it in sortie, entrée in Japanese. So, and Tsutomu means the character, the third character means force. Okay, so over, go through. Barriers means his name. Okay, so they consider a little bit the following. uh,
the following group scheme. the addition law is here defined by the formula 2-2-1. So it is U plus V plus H UV. Okay. So the previous formulas describe as before, this is similar to the story before, a morphism from this group, which I denoted S for Sekiguchi and Suwa, similarly to the multiplicative group, it is defined by some very simple formulas, okay? And similarly to the previous story, this is will be isomorphism for H different from zero. So we you see that it's this the formula 2-2-1. It's even simpler. Whereas in Lorentz formula, we take U plus V and divide by 1 plus H UV. Here we just take very, very simply, the most stupid way, U plus V plus H UV. Okay. Maybe it would be better actually to introduce two parameters. one coefficients at U plus V and another coefficients at UV. Maybe it would be, so you will have instead of a fine line of parameters, a projective line of parameters. So you see that when H is equal to zero, it is additive law. When H tends to infinity, it becomes, so to say, pure multiplicative. Okay. Now we can consider for the multiplicative group, we can consider the Kummer map, just the nth power series. And using our maps to multiplicative groups, we can form a commutative square, okay, as follows, where psi n is defined by this formula, 2-2-2, okay? So by taking this example as an example, we can do the same with the Lorentz group, also invent a commutative diagram, which is written here. So again, below is the Kummer map, upstairs we have the map defined by this formula. It's easy to check this formula, okay? So now Sekiguchi, Ort, and Suwa, they apply this group in a number theoretical situation. Okay. So SOS is their triple paper, which is in the references. Okay. To this end, let's consider the following field, and we consider it as the field of p-adic numbers and its cyclotomic extension by p's root of unity and the ring of integers inside it. I should say that this is a remarkable extension, a remarkable extension. P is a prime number. Okay, so what can we say? So K is a ring of integers. So if we take H equal to zeta minus one, then it will be uniformizing parameter. uniformizing parameter with the field of residues FP. Okay, and the whole section will be totally ramified. So H to the power P minus one is equal to WP, where W is a unit congruent to minus one modulo H. So for example, it's a nice exercise. For example, P equal three, we have this formula, H squared zeta minus one minus three zeta, and W is minus one minus H, okay? Okay, now this SOS, they consider the group SH as before. and the map where H is concrete here, so to say. And the map defined by, which is psi, psi P, which is equal to this expression. And because of 3-1-1, so this is because of this equality, H P minus one is P something, so it is divisible by pi, so it is defined. It's also it's there is some denominator. It's defined everywhere over K, and one sees actually so. We have a map, this map, and his special special fiber in this map will be the Artin-Schreier map. What does it mean? As I mentioned, our group S at the when H is equal to zero, its special fiber is just additive group. So. and when we reduce modulo H, our map psi P becomes Artin-Schreier map. Whereas from for H different from zero, it is actually Kummer map. So the whole scheme, the whole group scheme is actually nothing the deformation from Kummer to Artin-Schreier. I should say for the names, it was also considered by let me see the literature. Yes, it was considered by Waterhaus and Weisfeller actually these deformations, not in number theoretical context, but in algebraic context. Okay. So, yes. We can do the same thing with the Lorentz group, which is a which is a version of SOS group, and also define a map, a similar map from this group with parameter H to this group with parameter HP, which deforms as well after going to special fibers from Kummer to the Artin-Schreier at the limit. So once again, conclusion, what do we have? We have a family of groups which generically is multiplicative, and the special fiber is additive. And then on this family of this group, we have defined some maps, which some isogeny, which generically is after at the special fiber, we have the special fiber. We have for generic for H not equal to generically, it is a Kummer map,
and special fiber will be Artin-Schreier map. So it is, if you wish, it is a deformation from from a kernel of a map to fixed points, from kernel of a map to fixed points. Yes. Okay. So if we go back to 420, what is the relation to 420? We have now you see that we have considered we have considered the something two dimensional. We have two parameters. We have our h and h and which goes, we have a parameter of our torus and the parameter a parameter in our ring, and so this allows to the this allows to consider to develop an analog of Kummer theory for two-dimensional situation for arithmetic surfaces. So we have a curve in a mixed characteristic situation, and so for at the special fiber we have a we have a curve over FP, and in general we have a curve over ZP or QP. So we have two parameters of deformation, and in this case a two-dimensional a version of Kummer theory can be formulated. Namely, one can study the abelian cyclic abelian extension of this arithmetic surface. And here, the role of GM plays this Sekiguchi-Suwa group. Okay. Now, what brings the point of view, the Lorentz point of view? It brings the following, that this deformation appears not in vacuum, but inside SL2. So, whereas in the number theoretical papers, it appears as some abstract extension, here it appears inside SL2. And this might be of use. Okay. This I think is good. So let me make some concluding remark. So one remark is that it's rather open question. One remark is rather open question. So first remark is, it is interesting, in my opinion, to quantize this, which means to pass from SL2 to its quantized version, to the version of quantum group. And actually, it is not immediate. So. It turns out that it's not evident to construct inside the corresponding quantum group the corresponding a family. So we have a deformation parameter Q, and to construct a family of the corresponding
tori is it is not evident task, which I don't know the answer at the moment, but it is an interesting question. This is one thing. This is related to this Toyen with co-authors paper. Okay. The other remark is the following. We can also consider SL2. Look, SL2, its compact counterpart is SU2, which is S3, right? So S3 is a quaternionic analog of S1, right, of a circle. So this is can be considered as a quaternionic circle. This is a well-known analogy, and the classifying, if when we pass to classifying spaces, BS1 is infinite projective space. This is something whose cohomology is the cohomology of S1 with a shift, right? We can also form a quaternionic projective spaces. They exist, and in principle, it is interesting to consider the analog of theory, which I did discuss, of Toyen with co-authors, non-abelian quaternionic analog. What can be done, one can also think about non-associative analog. We know that there exists also an algebra of octonions, but in this case, the projective spaces exists only up to dimension 2. And here we come to the origin of octonions. And one can define the octonionic projective plane, not more at the moment, maybe more with derived geometry, and it is related to some classical questions from elementary geometry, to Dirac theorem, and etc. But this is a different story. Okay, so this is for the moment. This is what I wanted to say. So if you have any questions, so I will try to.
Thanks. Let's thank the speaker. Yeah, if there are questions, please. I have a rather weak question about relationship of, say, Lorentz business, which appeared in the beginning of the talk, and Sekiguchi-Ort Suwa construction. So as you told, Sekiguchi-Ort and Suwa constructed a group scheme such that its generic fiber is a torus and its special fiber is the additive group scheme, and with additional conditions on maps, say, Pomeran-Martin tribes. As to Lorentzian construction, it looks like it gives something at the level of formal group laws. So my question is, is it indeed equivalent, or Sekiguchi-Ort Suwa produced something stronger?
Yes. This is a good question. So, this is what I briefly mentioned. This is where I slightly cheated, or I don't know. You should consider. I think it is doable. I mean, this the only little thing which was not considered is this story of square roots. So I think that one should pass to some double covering or something and get not only on the level of formal groups, but on the level of groups. But for that, one should just pass to some two-fold covering of our group.
So you mean genuine group schemes, not?
Yes, I think groups. So. I didn't do this, but I think so.
Okay. Thank you. More questions, comments? If not, well, let's thank the speaker again.
And I want to thank you, Toda Raba, for the invitation.
It was a pleasure to be
in Be'er Sheva. This is my second time in Be'er Sheva.
No, we are not in Be'er Sheva. We are Bar Ilan is in the Ramat Gan.
So. Bar Ilan.
Yeah, Ben Gurion is in Be'er Sheva. Anyway, I stop recording and.